Hello, this week I finally managed to create a battery prototype in the new Seam, which is finally some kind of presentable. Here we see an early prototype where I finally got the collision detection working. There were many issues with the collision detection, which I am recreating here for the purpose of this specific video here. If we are starting with a negative electron pressure, the electrons would collide with the floor collider where the character controller is working on. In order to solve this issue, I created at least one additional layer where I put the marbles of the seams and the other objects of the seam, which are relevant to this layer. And finally, objects on this layer can only interact with other objects on this layer. So I have somehow two different layers which are relevant for the viewing of this application. Once you have the layer where you are working on and controlling your character, and the other part is this specific seam, which is using rigid bodies and interacting with specific objects here. The other seams are created by code, and the code is giving all game objects the exact position where to be. But in this specific seam, I'm using the engine, the physics engine, the physics of this engine, which originally was just a workaround, but seeing it now, not having to decide how many electrons go on each shovel, and it's all regulated by its own physics. It's looking quite more realistic. It's some kind of looking good, interesting, I think. It took me way more time to find out how to adjust the layer components than I'd like to admit. So, what you are seeing and what the collision detection algorithm is seeing are two different layers. Those green lines here are visualizing the game objects responsible for the collision detection. The visibility of the mesh objects of those game objects are hidden, they are invisible, they are turned off, and the mesh collision is still active of those game objects. That system makes the calculations within the program much faster. Besides having the double number of game objects, but the number of calculations the engine has to do in the background is much less, is lower. Also, worth mentioning is here the way I implemented the movement of the shovels. It is not like it appears here visually, that a shovel is going around the whole assembly belt. Instead, I take each shuffle and move it upwards a little bit, and
as soon as it has a specific change in the high, in the Y position, it instantly gets moved a few steps below. So it starts at the very same position as before, and there are those jumps within those animation which are invisible for the viewer. The main advantage of those jumps is that I also only need half of the numbers of the collision detection layers. So like you can see in this example here, you have the green parts of the shovels only on the side with the marbles. They do not have to be copied. The amount of layers interacting with the marbles does not have to be on both sides doubled. So I have the visible game objects of the shovel on both sides of this belt, but I only have the interacting parts on one side, and they always disappear and appear on the very same side.
The belt was programmed in a way that the height is adjustable. Here we can see it has a zero potential difference, and depending on the potential, it's higher or lower in size. A sudden change of potential of the battery makes the number of electrons also suddenly change. To solve this issue, I made some kind of backup system. This system regulates the number of electrons coming into the battery and also the number of electrons coming out of the battery. So in this example here, if there are way too many electrons on top in the upper shuffle, in the upper bucket of the battery, it just takes some electrons out. The electrons which are on the top side. And if there are not enough electrons in the upper bucket, it sometimes just add some electrons just for fun. So this system is also taking regularly some electrons out, and it's taking the very next electrons, which are interesting. This system puts some specific electrons as reserved electrons to be taken out, of the system, and they are reserved. And if there are no reserved electrons, also new electrons are being put into this upper shelf. So interesting part here is that the electrons which are being reserved are being pushed toward the exit slowly. They are being pushed towards the exit with the same velocity like the electrons would have in the regular circuit lines between those components. But here the velocity is a little bit higher, just in case if some electrons are faster, more away of the exit. But this issue doesn't appear at the moment here. But this is a very reason why there are sometimes some jumping electrons on top, because the algorithm doesn't know which is the most nearest electron and with which velocity it should move all the time towards the exit, so it doesn't have sudden jumps in the choosing part. However, this part is was to be made in a better way. However, it's good enough for a prototype right now. And at the bottom, I just take the expected velocity of the regular electrons, and depending on this time frame, new electrons are just being pushed in, and if the velocity of the electrons is high, the rate also becomes high. Here we see now a sudden change of the battery potential, and suddenly we have way more shuffles within this battery, and the amount of electrons being pushed into the battery per time interval is higher. So we have from this point on way more electrons on each shovel than before. And it's taking some time until this update information is arriving at the top of the battery. And until we have this regular rhythmus again, electrons are being pushed onto the top from a magic hand, let's say, out of thin air. I would also like to talk about the way I implemented the conveyor belt per se. I had some multiple ideas to choose from. Here we have a closer look at the one I decided to take. At the beginning, I wanted to make the shovels also turn around when they reach the top, so that the part becomes thinner, which is going backwards. And this would have solved many problems. But I also was thinking that this could become too complicated to think about while the animation is running, and the main problem was I still didn't want to have anything where you have much to think about the mechanics, because on one hand I didn't want the viewer to be possible to argue like, why does this shuffle go towards the other object, but I also wanted to have a very simple explanation which comes close to reality and is understandable real quick, real fast. So I decided to just use this kind of grid system with those grids. And the main argument against this was at the very beginning, or let's say it's still one argument that is interesting, is that it needs a lot of vertices. It doesn't make the game object simple anymore. So for the prototype, I decided to still go this way and decided to design those shovels with many vertices, with many polygons. And in the long run, I have the idea that I could use also the work of the principle of low-level game objects, of high level of details. Game objects, and the faster the player
goes away of those batteries, the more simple those game objects become. But in this prototype here, I don't care at this specific moment because I want to have something done, something that is presentable at the moment, and having just a few batteries at the scene shouldn't cause problems at the moment. But the original goal was to be able to create a lot of batteries, and for this I would have to work with level of detail game objects in the long run. However, another additional idea was that I just use a different shader which allows transparency, so I would have a very thin layer of metal at this point, and the parts where the marbles can't go through would just be an invisible part on the texture. But for the time being, I decided against having multiple shaders within the battery game object. Before I came up with this specific version of the battery, I had some prototypes in mind, and here I draw some sketches on how they could have looked. And yeah, it's there are different kind of ideas here. I had at first in mind the conveyor belt to go up on one side and go down on the other side, but that would have taken quite a lot of space, and I already assumed that there could be possibilities where let's say there's a short wire, where a lot of electrons would have to come through the battery, and you would have to be able to carry many electrons on one shovel, and this system could not have been efficient. So I didn't use this specific one here. I wanted to make it visually appealing to have many electrons and not having to think what's going backwards on the very same game object, and why are there electrons falling down on the other hand if they can't pass through on top. So in an additional version of the battery, I would have set the position of the conveyor belt not in the middle, but more sideways, so that the shuffles would have had to go outside of the battery, at least the ones returning to the starting point. And this, however, I was thinking could have caused other issues, and I still wanted to keep all parts of the battery within the designated area. And also this version I didn't use. However, there was still one version I was quite thinking about. In this concept, the plane, the marbles would have been pushed up, would have been sideways of the battery. Here they would have been pushed upwards, and after turning the highest point, they would roll backwards into the bucket where the electrons are going out. So in this example here, the kind of orientation of the shovels would have had been very specific, because while the marbles are being pushed up, the shovel would have to be declined towards this green area here, and right on the top they would roll towards the center, and being at the center they would change the shuffle and they would go on the back side of another shuffle, not the very same shuffle but another shuffle, and because of this change they would realize the change of angle and roll towards the top bucket of collection.
Okay, one last thing worth mentioning for this episode is the way I implemented the conveyor belt per se. In an old project I had the concept already used once, where I built the conveyor belt out of four main components, and those components could have a high level of detail, and I could have worked with a level of detail for those game objects as a system, but let's say it could have had a high level of detail with many vertices and polygons, but the main advantage would have been that there are only four game objects, and this is an important part. And having only four game objects, it would be easy for the calculations, because the two game objects symbolizing the main part of the conveyor belt would implicit said there are many shovels on the very same game object. So the green part here would symbolize to have a lot of sticks on it, but in reality it would be only one single game object, and this would be part of the illusion with this system. And the upper part, the roll, is only turning for a specific amount of angle, and in this example here we would have 1, 2, 3, 4 parts on the hole itself, and after having moved declined turned around for 45 degree, it would suddenly go backwards for 45 degree, exactly 45 degree, independent whether I have now 46 degree, 47 degree, or let's say 50 degree. It would always roll back exactly 45 degrees, because we have also to consider the delta time between the frames. However, it would have caused the illusion that it is going around as intended, and there would be a lot of single game objects moving around, but in fact there would have been only those four, where two are moving, where two are having a translation and two are having a rotation applied. I decided against this system because I wanted to have something even more simple, and I decided to also create those game objects and texture those game objects, but texture them in a specific way. So I textured it looking already forward, that I'm able to change the XY position of the texture on the shader, and I'm moving the texture of this game object. And this makes it appear for the eye
that the conveyor belt is moving. One thing I had to come up was the middle part of the conveyor belt, where I was first thinking I create it out of code dynamically, but then I came up with a even more simplified idea, which would make no difference in the eye of the viewer. I just scale the middle part, but then I also have to scale the texture part of the middle component. And I think this has also some advantages and disadvantages, but I didn't care any longer at this part and just wanted to have something which is done real quick and looks some kind of appealing in the eye of the viewer, so that the illusion of a movement is working and it's done. I can really imagine that there are way more professional ways to implement such an idea, such a concept, but this is how I did it for the prototype at least, and I'm happy it's looking how it is right now, because I expected something worse, and it's the current position of the development. Okay, thanks for watching.